This is a nice figure also showing the different regions of WHO, Africa, the Americas, Eastern Mediterranean, Europe, Southeast Asia, and Western Pacific. Again, the dotted line is the goal, okay, the MDGs goal. But this one reflects the mortality rate, the global mortality rate, excluding those who are HIV positive. The mortality rate in globally has fallen 47% in this timeline. Some of these regions have done much better than others, are still close to the goal, but not there yet. Another important issue about tuberculosis, and this is true also for malaria, even though I didn't touch it, but is drug resistant. Okay, we all know how long and how many drugs we have to take when you are infected with tuberculosis. Anybody, maybe a doctor among you would like to share now a comment? No. Okay, everybody is shy. Okay, I'll do it then. So the first line of treatment for tuberculosis, you have to take several drugs for 6 months. So 6 months taking the drugs, okay? Then you have, of course, second line therapy and so on. But a big issue would be multi-drug resistant. Multi-drug resistant tuberculosis is when you develop resistant to at least rifampicin or isoniazid, which are two of the most powerful first-line anti-TB drugs. So imagine you have the first line you have to take for 6 months, and then you stop taking, you develop resistant to the drugs. And even more dramatic would be that you develop more resistant to the second line. Extensively drug-resistant tuberculosis, or XDR-TB, is multi-drug resistant, so resistant to these two first-line drugs, plus resistant to at least one fluoroquinolone and a second line injectable drug. So these poses a big challenge to the fight and the control of the epidemic. The first it was first identified in South Africa in 2005, extensively drug-resistant tuberculosis. And it will definitely pose a threat, not only to the country where it arises, but globally, to control the tuberculosis epidemic. So globally, and this is talking about drug-resistant tuberculosis, globally, we estimate 3.3% of new tuberculosis cases and 20% of those previously treated cases as having multi-drug resistant tuberculosis. And this will remain, it has remained virtually unchanged in recent years. Extensively drug resistant tuberculosis has been reported by already 105 countries by 2015. And an estimated nearly 10% of the people with multi-drug resistant tuberculosis have extensive drug resistant tuberculosis. In 2014, there were an estimated more than 400,000 new cases of multi-drug resistant tuberculosis worldwide. And nearly 200,000 people die from multi-drug resistant tuberculosis. If we see here now globally, the number, this is the number of multidrug resistant tuberculosis that is estimated to occur among those who are notified of tuberculosis. This is for the year 2014. So more than half of the patients were in India, China, and the Russian Federation. So you can see here with the darker colors. So what is driving the emergence and the re-emerging of infectious diseases? Along my talk, I have mentioned few of them. Now we'll try to put them a little more organized. So we have different drivers, and the list is increasing. First, the increasing population. Okay, population is growing. The explosive increase in the number and rapidity of commutation. Now you can go from one place to another in few hours. In only one day, you can go across the globe, right? The import and the export of food stock is also a driving factor. Some diseases of development, like construction of dams, can also affect. The expansion of human residential area, more urbanization, growing spaces, and moving away some hosts. The import and the export of animals, the breeding of large quantity of poultry, and definitely despite some group of people trying to reject this, the global warming and the climate change, very much real and also affecting. War and refugees, I have slightly mentioned also how in some of these diseases, war and refugees movement also can affect the spread of disease. The increasing nursery schools, and I think if there are some mothers here or people having small children, you may know that once your children start going to nursery, they start getting a lot of diseases, not only care, but the kids will share a lot of these viruses or bacteria. Increasing elderly care facilities, again, the same people confined in a place also will increase the risk and the possibilities of getting an infection. The abuse of antibiotics. Maybe in Japan is much more restricted, the use of antibiotics, but in many other places of the world, not only medical doctors prescribing a lot of antibiotics many times were not necessarily needed, but also you can obtain antibiotics over the counter very easily without a prescription. Okay, so this also fuels the resistance. Increased virulence of pathogens. We have seen how pathogens are constantly mutating and changing and evolving and posing and constantly challenged to the advancement of technology. And of course, we cannot forget about bioterrorism. Unfortunately, it's still a threat. So I'm not going to go over each and every one of them, but you can see a little of a few of them now reorganized. This is taken from a paper published in Emerging Infectious Diseases, How Appropriate the Journal, Factors in the Emergence of Infectious Diseases. And you can see here some factors. These are the factors. And examples of specific factors under these titles. And examples of diseases that they may be related to. Okay, for example, if we see here human demographics and behavior as a factor, society events, population growth and migration, people moving especially from rural areas to urban areas or now displacing from one country to another, war or civil conflict in many parts of the world. They are experiencing war and conflict still, urban decay or different sexual behavior, as for instance, intravenous drug use or maybe use of high density facilities. All these may have played a role in introducing HIV, for example, the spread of dengue, the spread of HIV, and other sexually transmitted infections. Okay, we now have seen also how international travel and commerce also is playing a huge role. We mentioned how in only one day we can go from one place, one point in the globe, to the complete opposite part of the globe. So worldwide movement of not only people, but also goods, and the air travel facilitates, okay, with people and with goods, also some bacteria, some viruses, and some other illnesses may be traveling along. The airport malaria, dissemination of mosquito vectors, are some of these examples. This is a report from CDC in the United States. It says Lassa fever confirming death of US traveler returning from Liberia. So a person was coming back, maybe home, from a different country. And the importance of all these texts is the patient did not have a fever on departure from Liberia, did not report symptoms such as diarrhea, vomiting, or bleeding during the flight. And his temperature was taken on arrival in the US, and he did not have a fever at that time. Okay, so they travel so fast, they don't have time to develop any symptoms, but yet they develop on the other side, and then they may be risking also other people. These are some examples of how, again, a little more, and I cannot emphasize these more, how diverse environmental changes can affect also the occurrence of various infectious diseases. And this is taken from the WHO. If you are curious to read a little bit more about it, at the bottom of the slides, I put the URL. They're all shortened URLs, so I didn't want to put a very long one. But here you can see how environmental changes can also be involved and relate to the spread of different diseases and how these, what is the pathway to do this. Here you can read later with more details about dams and canals and irrigations activities also, maybe helping the spread of malaria or schistosomiasis and so on. Some agricultural intensification or urbanization and urban crowding, how putting more people in a confined space also can fuel, for instance, outbreaks of cholera, dengue, or other diseases. Deforestation and new habitation for the mosquitoes, for instance, or reforestation, or ocean warming, or more precipitation, more rain, okay? Climate change, it's raining more, so it's changing the environment also. So this is the last slide. You have seen last week how infectious disease severely and dramatically affected human population throughout history. And now you have seen also how it's currently still affecting much of the population, especially to some regions in the world. So this is for us to remember that the infectious diseases are still very persistent threat. And most of these threats and these deaths are occurring in low and middle income countries. So we still have very much to be vigilant and aware of this. Okay, thank you very much. This is my last slide. If you have any